So I'm going to get this talk started because it's long and I like to talk, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to actually finish in time. And I really want to try to, I know there's a lot of international speakers and I have a habit of speaking very fast. So I'm actually starting on time today.
Mic closer, please.
Okay. I'm like making love to this mic up here. You shouldn't give me a mic like this. This is dangerous. Just a little bit of history on this talk. This is my third time giving this talk this year, so it's awesome because I didn't stay up all night preparing my slides. But it's also changed every single time I've done it. And the first time that I did this talk, I went up with a warning, and I was quite pissed off, and this was in Munich. And I was really pissed off because I was really just tired of having a shitty API and having to try to manage people and get things done in Plone. And so I came with this warning and saying that, you know, I was going to give this really crazy talk and it was filled with anger. But every time I've done this talk since, I've become disgustingly more positive about Plone. So I want to apologize in advance for all of the warm, gooey feelings that are going to come from this talk because that was not the original intention at all. In great ways. So I think most of you are developers, as I saw from Nate's talk earlier. And David is going to talk all about what was happening in 4.1, 2, and 3. But I do know that some of you probably haven't updated to Plone 4 yet. And you should really check it out and get in there, not only for performance reasons, but because the UI and many, many things has been updated. And I think that we've done a lot of modernizing in Plone 4. So we did a lot of modernizing, not just of the UI, but of the architecture underneath. And it's been a really great opportunity and chance to work on the framework team, and we're looking for people. So if you're not very familiar, go to David's talk, and he's going to go into depth into all the things that happened. But what we really saw is we saw two modernizations. We saw it in the user interface, so that the end user is going in. We have better collections interfaces. We saw dexterity, changing the content type creation, things like that, things that we've been talking about for a while. And events hasn't made it into 4.3 yet, but is Johannes here? He's going to make it into the next release, I think. So you'll see the new Plone events interface coming up as well. And also modernizing the architecture. We're keeping up with Zopes, lots of speed improvements, running on Python 2.7, things like that. So these are things that we've needed for a long time. And really, really happened in Plone 4 series, and I'm really happy and excited with everything that's happened. And top that off with really, really easy and nice migration steps. It really made it nice. So if you remember a lot of pain in the past of being like, well, I don't want to go 3.1 to 3.2 because it's going to break everything, I think in Plone 4 there was a really good, all the implementers did a great job of making that a pretty seamless upgrade. So no need to be afraid. We also updated the PLIP processes a lot. So instead of doing a call for PLIPs, does anybody not know what a PLIP is? You can admit it. Okay, awesome. That means that there's like double that. Okay, so PLIP is a Plone improvement proposal. So we know that Plone isn't perfect out of the box, although it's pretty close, right? So we do have people that propose changes to core. So if you look at Plone and you say, man, you know what would be really, really awesome is if you went to the live search and it showed the last 5 pages that you were at by default, and you think that it's such a good feature that it should be in Plone by default, you would write a PLIP. There's nobody that says what must be made PLIP or what hasn't been made a PLIP, and I think this is one of the biggest misconceptions is a lot of people, when they start working with Plone, think that if a roadmap team writes a document, that that's exactly how it's going to be, but that's not the case. We rely on things from people like you to say, it would be really great if this happened, and I'm willing to do the work to make it happen. So in the past, PLIPs, we did a call for them, and then we would do a release, and it was a really, really static fixed release process, and we've moved to a much more agile process now, where you can submit a PLIP at any time, and we'll review it and give you feedback on code. We're trying to provide mentorship for people who hadn't written PLIPs in the past. We're still working on it, so it's not 100% perfect, but if you have an idea for Plone and you think that it should be in core, let us know. So because of that, basically we do an alpha release almost immediately after the actual release. So 4.2 was released and we had a 4.3 alpha, I think, a week later. And many thanks to the release manager for putting up with all that shit, because it's really quite a juggling act. But what we want to do is get stuff in your hands as fast as you can. So what we see right here is, one, we have a lot more PUPs coming in because we have a process where you can submit them anytime. So we're hoping for 404 to keep that trend going up. And then furthermore, the release process, the time from last release to alpha has dramatically shrinked, but now the time from alpha, beta to an actual release candidate is extremely long. So that's because we want you to download it, test it, and let us know what's actually happening. Development-wise, we're also in a really big effort to try to clean up track. I know that I go on and on about this a lot, but it's actually quite a serious problem. We started and we had about 1,600 open tickets, and now we're down to 1,132. And what does that mean? That means it's almost impossible for us to actually know what's wrong with Plone. I mean, it's much under much better control right now. But if you think of any chance of trying to get that down, that's 8 tickets per current core contributor that would have to be closed in order to make this happen with our current level. So, but in addition to that, we also have an average of 3.4 new tickets per day. So we really do have a ticket emergency, which is getting better, and we're getting things done. And there's 2 ways to fix that. One is to just close a bunch of tickets and then wait for people to yell at me, which was my current strategy, so I apologize. The other thing is to try to get more core contributors. So that's going to be my biggest thing. So if we can get 4 tickets per core contributor, if you have a core agreement, you can close 4 tickets, then by the end of 1 year from now, we could be down to an actually manageable sized ticket tracker of 250. So some of these are easy. Here's a little bit of a breakdown to see how that's distributed. We have 376 feature requests in there, which I might go on a closing spree this week. But and these are the ones that nobody looks at, so that can happen. But the main issue is the 729 bugs. Many of these have been reconfirmed in Plone 4. I think the oldest ticket that I reconfirmed that was still open was 8 years old and still exists in Plone 4. So there's a lot of really interesting things happening there. But the good thing is that a lot of them are in, 600 of them are in the 4.x series, and they've all been confirmed and known issues. So if you're sprinting this weekend and you're not exactly sure where to start, or maybe this is your first sprint and you just signed your core developer agreement, you know, please come find me, and I will happily get you really easy tickets. Even though it's not a tune-up process, it's the best way to get started with developing in Plone. In addition to all that, the amount of add-ons we're having per week is really phenomenal. I think that there's this classic argument that happens where people would say, well, Plone is an end-user platform, and then, no, Plone is a development platform. And I'm kind of here to tell you it's a development platform and a user platform, but we can't ignore both. And there's a lot of proof towards that. If we're having 20 new add-ons in a month, that's 1 add-on per day. I don't think there's any way that we can argue that customization, that we can't look at the developer as the user in addition to the actual user itself. And that's in growing. And here's more more information to that. So again, I've done this talk 3 times, and I update this slide every time I come. So one month ago, I did this, and the collective had 560 repositories and 150 members. 1 month later, it has 680 repos and 279 members. Like, that's amazing. That I was updating the stats, and I was like, whoever's sitting next to me, I'm like, you got to see this. This is crazy how much the collective is happening. In addition, Plone, the number of repos is actually going down, which is awesome. It goes up and down by 1 or 2 packages, but the number of packages in Plone Core is becoming dramatically simplified thanks to a lot of really good work from people. And last month, it had 150 core contributor members in the GitHub, but now we have 190. So 40 new members in 1 month is pretty amazing. But the main point here is that we have everybody working. We have a lot of work happening on the outskirts of Plone in terms of add-ons and things that are happening not in core. And I really want to try to convince you to redirect some of your work in add-ons and pull it into core and helping us get core fixed up and cleaned up. All those tickets in the tracker are for core. And obviously everybody's capable. It's just getting them convinced to do it. Okay, so in 2007, I found these really great slides that for, well, several people did talks about what is Clone 5 and what is it going to be. And then it was Deco and Tiles, and if you were here talking and you saw Garbus David talk earlier on Deco and Tiles and what that's happening, there was a lot of focus on performance, usability, and one content type. Well, it's 2012, so it's 5 years, so there was a lot of people who were really disappointed that that didn't happen. But I think that's because the expectations were really too high. And there was a lot of discussion that happened earlier this year of like, well, what is Clone 5? And really what happens is Clone 5 is whatever Eric says Clone 5 is. Mike. So, sorry. Sorry, this is really close though. You can even hear me breathing. awkward. So, you know, Mozilla taught us all that numbers don't mean anything. So Plone 5 is whatever Eric says Plone 5 is. And we really needed to pare it down and make things happen. So we had this wonderful, wonderful roadmap team came out and gave us the short-term and medium-term things. And actually, most of these have been done. So I'm looking forward to seeing how that gets updated and what's happening. But then there was concern in the community about, like, well, why does the roadmap team, you know, get to decide what happens? And why does the framework team get to decide what happens? And for those that are new to the process, it's not really like that. You know, there is a lot of misconception that these teams are the people who decide what's happening, or that one person or that Martin is the one who's telling everybody what to do. And it really is a lot of things. And well, I have this little graph here, which actually shows, you know, we have all these vectors of influence. You know, we have community, we have direction, we have, you know, people who resist change. And what we really want to do is get to Plone 5. And one of the things that I found really interesting that happened over the last probably 3 years was the bitterness vector, and bitterness and waiting for things to get fixed. And that kind of stopped Plone 5 quite a bit, or the next version of Plone. And I really think that this conference especially, I'm seeing that completely change over, and a lot of excitement going over that. So if the developers and people who have been here historically have felt really upset or bitter about how things have happened, you know, I just want to say this is your chance to come in and be enabled to do things. And I think that Plone API is a perfect example of that. You know, we do want to fix things and we want to make you guys happy again. So there was, Plone 3 was an interesting release. And, understatement. And it caused a big riff. And when Eric gave his keynote, he showed what happened in Plone 3. Not only did we have a recession, but we also had Plone 3. We had a lot of bitterness. We had a lot of people leave the community and all this stuff. And you can see that in the activity on the developers list. And it's all picking up again. However, we still have this huge problem of approachability, obviously, and complexity, and trying to justify it, right? So this is my favorite Stack Overflow question from 2008 that still gets updated to this day, and is how do you justify the complexity of Plone? And in approachability, saying, you know, this guy was just like, I don't know if Plone is right for me, and I can't really get ramped up on it to even decide if it's a potentially good solution. So I think that that's a little bit of a regression, and that's because I'm a big 2.5 fanboy, but we just really need to and not rely on the roadmap team or the framework team or any of these people. We as developers need to accept this and fix this. This is something that we have to work together and make it happen. And I think that there's a lot of dichotomy, and people kind of get this us versus them notion where, you know, on the left here we have these XML configuration, you know, really good test coverage, you know, and to be honest, once you get to a certain level in Plone, the hard things become insanely easy. It's disgusting. But then, you know, you try to have a customer change the logo and you're like, well, you have to do a viewlet for that. So I really want to take the developer community and refocus them on making the easy things easy. And the good thing is that's really easy. And we really just need to get back to thinking about programming. And Plone API is the first start of this, but it's by no means the end game, right? Programming is more than just a nice API. It's the way we interact with each other, and it's the way we build add-ons, and it's the way we fix core. So, and I got really passionate about this. I think it's a really interesting story, is I started teaching a Python web development class to complete newbies, like people who didn't know any Python. And they're like, well, we don't only want to learn Python, we want to get web development jobs, and we want to learn Django, because Django is the hot stuff these days, especially in San Francisco. So I use this as an excuse to do that thing that we always want to do, and that's to build the same application in three different frameworks, and actually it's four now. And we only have 3 hours per framework to get them ramped up on how to do a to-do list. So just basically add an item to a to-do list and then check it off. Obviously, this is quite difficult because you have CSS, you have JavaScript, you have HTML, you have a lot of concepts. But the wonderful thing was that I got exposed to the different ways that people do things and the way their code looks. And in the end, the users got to decide what they wanted to do their class project in. And it turned out they all wanted to do Flask. And the thing that happened with Flask is that writing the code was just so much fun and so simple for them. And I was just sitting there looking at them, and I was like, man, we can do that. There's no reason we can't have wonderful syntax if we just get over the notion that somebody's going to shoot us down. So since then, I've really focused on when I'm writing code for somebody else to use is like starting with the code first. You know, you have your README stuff and you need to do all that, but if you are writing a new API and you actually just use the API before you like sit down and code it up, you come up with a completely different answer. So for example, here we have a simple contact page, which is how you would do it in Flask with a little bit of Plony terminology. And I was like, yeah, that would be really great to do that in Plone. And then I was like, there's no reason I can't do that and make that happen and try it as an add-on. And I think we all have our config or our shortcuts file, and we all have that, and we really just need to coordinate that a little bit better. And Plone API is a great start, but I don't think that that should be the end or even, you know, close to the end. We have a lot of things to do still. So what it really comes down to is a lack of syntactic sugar. And Plone API is totally hitting this on many, many points, is reducing the number of files we need to touch, making it easier to recall things off of the top of your head. You know, it's a really, really simple thing when you stand up here and talk about it, but it is really difficult. But everybody has ideas, and we need to actually, if you have ideas, talk to Nate, talk to somebody else and say, I really think that this would be an important way to make it easier to develop in Plone. And that's something that expert Plone developers shouldn't be doing. This is something that those of you who just said they didn't know what a PLIP is and maybe don't fully in there, that's stuff that we want to hear from you, because we've been in this for so long that it's hard for us to see anymore what really is the hard part. And so this is what we need from newbies. We don't need documentation. We need feedback, and how do we make it easier? And I think that in 6 months, it's been dramatically different perspective, but I encourage everybody to continue this. And furthermore, there's always talk about documentation, and I think documentation is a scapegoat for just complicated ideas that haven't been vetted, or that, which is, it happens. I mean, we write software, but I would much prefer a clean API that makes sense when I read it, when I'm reading the code, and I can say, I need to use this function, versus going and reading 20 pages of documentation. And the best part about that is I don't think any of us want to write documentation. So let's just write better APIs. And that's not just core. I mean, I don't mean this is core at all. I totally mean this is in every aspect of Plone. Like, we all know that add-on that makes your eyes bleed when you look at the code. So let's help each other. Let's work with each other and give each other feedback. And I'd like to call this developer-driven development, which is, it's completely just a name, but it is thinking about your peers, like thinking about the person that's going to use that code that you hung out with last night and had drinks with and bought you drinks, and being like, how pissed are they going to be when they see my API or when they try to use my add-on? And take all this love that we have for each other as a community in person and as friends, and turn that into love for the code that we're writing. And for me, Plone 5, it is about making happy developers. And I'm going to ride that bandwagon until that bitch is released. Because we have an opportunity that it's been 10 years, which means we have a whole new generation of people that don't know what Plone is. So those of us that have been around have always had that conversation of like, oh yeah, I used Zope once. Or, you know, I used Plone 20 years ago, and I bet it's still bad. But we really have a great opportunity, you know, starting now, to take a whole new generation of people who will never experience these technologies. And let's do that. Let's take advantage of that and make it easy and fun to develop in Plone. Well, maybe fun. Let's start with fun. And I think that this isn't just a developer thing. This is a business decision, right? So I'm getting a little bit older. It happens. And doing that classic route from developer into managing more people. And you know, there really is a really good business reason for encouraging your developers not only to write good code and to contribute back, but to be interested in Plone the community itself. And I think hiring is one of the main things that most of us have problems with, like especially at this conference. I feel like I'm always poaching from somebody that I know. And then I'm like, oh, I'd really love it if so-and-so worked for me, but then their team would be depleted and there's no Plone developers. So it really should be a vested interest to get people excited, new people into Plone, to make it easier to hire people. Because otherwise, they're just gonna, it's impossible. We're just gonna poach from each other and nothing's gonna get done. So if people can get ramped up on Plone, they don't see it as a liability to their career, which is the problem right now. New people think Plone is a liability to their career. Then we'll make it better for all of us. And the best way to do that is make an easy ramp up, nice, fun API that at least they can say, well, that was fun, even though it didn't last forever. It's not a high risk framework to learn. Plone will never be hip. I'm in San Francisco, and so I think I'm a little bit overexposed to the hipness of technology. You can't go to a bar without hearing about the latest NoSQL database and all these things. And so we just have to get off that idea that we need to be cool again and compete with Drupal and compete with all these things and find our niche. And that's for hiring. And right now, my best chance of hiring is usually finding .NET developers or old Java developers, because for them, it's much simpler. And I think that's really sad. So, I mean, it's really bad. They're great Python developers, though. So we really need to work on making a thriving community, and not just as friends, but as professionals and peers, because our community is really great person to person, but we have to work on our developer-on-developer crimes. Furthermore, more importantly, I am deathly afraid to fire people, and there's some people that need to be fired. And the thing is you get rid of somebody and you don't know when the next Plone person is going to come by. And that's scary. Not just scary as somebody who's trying to build a product or run a consulting company, but it's scary in terms of, you know, the community itself and replenishing core and making things happen. We really need to focus on that. And I really think that happy developers and making Plone a good experience first up, even if they quit after a year, that's fine. At least we have a starting ramp-up time where it is not so dangerous to recommend to a client that you use Plone. Like, I want to be able to be fired myself. I think we all, as consultants, have these clients that we would just love to fire. They're awful, but you feel so bad because you know that they can't hire anybody else, or it's hard to find somebody. So let's make that a possibility for them. And is a Spanky in here? Yay! So one of those things is when we're writing, when we write add-ons, we have this nice little, when you put your add-on on Plone.org, it's like all this checklist of things that you need to be doing, which we don't have a checklist for core, which is kind of crazy. But, you know, when you're writing add-ons, when you're writing code, think about, is this usable by an average developer? And if it's not, talk to me. Have Spanky use it. He's a self-professed average developer, and he's really, really smart, and he's a great, you know, front-end guy. And he's just a great test of saying, is it going to be okay? Can he use it? Is he going to pull his hair out before the end of his experience with my add-on or with this change that I'm making or this plip? And it's amazing what different results come when you think about that. So this is the other thing, is that if we continue to be in denial about Plone as being a development platform, which we're getting better about accepting it, but there's still a huge faction of the community that doesn't like to think of this. But, you know, the best way, Joel Spolsky is an American tech writer. He used to work at Microsoft. And I think that this really rings true. Is like the best way to kill a platform is to make it hard for developers to build on. And you have to recognize that we're building a platform. And Plone is a platform. And with the number of add-ons we see, I don't think there's any way to deny that, personal experience aside, of course. So after I did this talk in Munich, it was a lot of rabbling. people really got together immediately. Nate's talked and he started Plone API there. The Germans were very excited. And we had basically a bitch session. And I think there was like 40 people there. And it was in German, so it was all translated for me. But it was pretty amazing. And everybody got a list of things that pissed them off about Plone. And we did it in Google Moderator. And we got these really great, solid top 10 things that make Plone hard to develop in. So I think that not only do we now have a list, now we need to actually work on it. And I'm going to pass by this a little bit. But we have we probably had 300 people respond to this. And this is the in order. We already are working on it. So Plone API is going to grapple the first two, for example, cleaning things up. The one thing he didn't mention in his talk that's really important about Plone API is if we have a solid interface over top, it's going to be easier for us to go in and rip things out in the back end and clean it up. It's still a long process, but it absolutely has to happen. If you can help with any of these things or if you have any free time, some of them can be, most of them have to be pipped because, not because we expect you to go through a review process, but because they should happen with a release and be planned accordingly. But if you can do any of these things, let me know. You can obviously sprint on Plone API, and you can hit up in these shortcuts that we need. Components and browser views, Zope 2, Zope 3, Zope 5, Zope whatever, that needs to be cleaned up. We need to really make a decision on CMF, if we're pulling it out or if we're not pulling it out. And I'm actually going to be doing some of that sprinting this weekend. Documentation and core, and actually this is something that's kind of started. One of the things we realized is that we need translations for our core docs. So not just user translations, but I only speak Portuguese and I need to know how to set up my build out environment. And that was a little bit more of a realization. And then the to-do tutorial that Nate's mentioned earlier is the same thing, is we want our documentation to be running against code in core. So keeping things up to date. I mean, I think we've all experienced going to a page on LDAP integration and seeing that it was for Plone 2. So how do we fix that problem? And we really need some docs leadership there. So if anybody is really passionate about taking that, find myself or basically anybody here, and we can get you set up. The CMF templates, so CPY, VPY, all these files, which those of us that have been around for a while, we know about them. We need to get those out. Little known fact is that all the editing, deleting, log in, log out, all happens in portal skin still. And it's a scary change, but it's something that's so simple and so easy to pull out and will make customization completely different for those things, but will make it a complete and solid story so that there's not five different ways to do things. So there's a sprint on that this weekend. It's just taking these little things like, why should editing an object be in portal skins? It shouldn't be there anymore. Anyway, so this is going to be online. So either talk to myself with your skills, or feel free to go online and look at them and see what these are. But these are all things that people here in Plone said that they wanted to fix, and so we're working on it. And we have a list, and I hope that I can continue to update this and make these boxes green and say, okay, that's done. And these are not all of them are hard things. They're pretty easy. So Plone 5, or whatever that ends up being calling, is the next release. Eric has several different requests on things that we need to do. And anything with a star next to it needs somebody to plip it. Plip shouldn't be, for those who don't know, it's not a scary process, actually. It's a really good learning process. And we really want, if anybody wants to sit and get some mentorship, it's a great way to get ramped up and have people help you with clean stuff. So, for example, we want to make archetypes optional. So we're missing some widgets and dexterity. I'm sure that David can talk a little bit more to that. But making sure that we can really put the default Plone types in dexterity and then choose your setup when you set up a Plone site. Continuing to factor out unnecessary packages. KSS, everybody say, yay, no KSS, woo. So David's been working on that, and that's going to be really amazing, pulling out archetypes for those that don't want to use it, which is still going to be there. Don't freak out, archetypes lovers. You can still use it. JavaScript date format, the date formatting is internationalization of dates, and because we are moving to a more JavaScript-based thing. So we do need to worry about things like internationalization, and you know, it's still incredibly difficult to do a simple translation on date, for example. I know that how pissed off I was when I had to create a PO file just so that I could change the date format. So things like that. Plone API, we've already mentioned that a few of us have told Nates that we want it in core. I don't think anybody who hasn't used it, you'll use it once and you'll be like, do it. So, but we need a PLIP. So wherever he is he in here? PLIP it. And it's not because we think that it needs review. It's because we want to make sure we time it right. We're very sensitive to timing and making sure that we don't have, we're not screwing anybody, that nobody's platforms break, et cetera, et cetera. So in summary, I really think that Plone 4 did a really great job, and like I said, I kind of skipped over that, but David's going to cover that in his talk, modernizing the Plone user experience, and I think that Plone 5 should be modernizing the Plone developer experience, and if we can get behind that, then we can get pretty far. Back into culture. Plone 5 should also have a new culture thing. I think we've learned a lot, and everybody who's been in Plone a while will say that, yeah, we've been leading the way, especially in technology, but we really lead well, I think the best, in community culture. And for anybody that this is your first conference, I hope that you leave thinking that this is the awesomest place to be, because it really is. But we need to work on some things and some expectations. One of my major gripes is, especially with businesses and developers, is kind of waiting for Kotti or waiting for the next CMS and Pyramid because people aren't sure what's going to happen to Plone. Well, waiting, just makes Plone stay where it is and not do anything. So, you know, there's some point where I woke up and I was like, you know, I want to commit to Plone. Like, I'm in it for the long run. Like, this is a relationship that I'm going to build. And I made that decision. And I want to encourage anybody who does sit on the fence to make a decision either way, because it's not good for either project, like either Kotti or, you know, whatever the Pyramid Plone replacement is going to be. It doesn't work for either any of these projects if everybody's just waiting to see what happens. So kind of shit or get off the pot type thing. You know, we talk about committing and getting more committers, and there's a lot of different ways that you commit. It's not just committing code. I think that one of the best things that we can do right now, and that I'm seeing more, is get businesses to commit to Plone, right? And yes, it's been a rough, 3 years because of the economy and all these things, but now is a great time to come back and say, yes, I am a Plone shop. I want to help the Plone community. We have our things, and let's do it. So I think that we should make a resolution, a new Plone year resolution, since Plone years start at the conference and end at the conference. It's like fiscal year. But anyway, so there's little things that you can do as a business owner, or maybe you're independent, or maybe you work with other people, that can help Plone, and they cost so little and don't cost you money or cost your clients money. For example, just say that when you fill out your paperwork that gives your taxes, give them a contributor agreement. Like, print it out, send it in for them, and say, we do contribute to Plone, and then explain to them what your policy is, having a policy and contributing back. I think that one of the biggest things when I talk to people, because I really get frustrated that people don't contribute, and they say, I don't know when, I don't know how, I don't know what my company says. But you know what? They can't fix that. Business leaders can fix that. People running companies can fix that. So that's something that's super simple. Give them the paperwork and throw in a contributor agreement and a quick explanation about what goes back and what doesn't. Really, really simple. Persisting Plone culture. So a lot of, you know, when somebody comes on, doing things like telling them that your company is on IRC and that's where they should be. You know, install the client if it needs to be. If you're a Plone shop and you hire a designer, there's no problem with putting, you know, Adium or whatever it is on their machine before they get in and saying, you know, I know you don't know IRC, but this is where everything is, and this is where you're going to go for help. It's those little tiny things that really help people a lot. Bringing on developers isn't just bringing them onto your code base. It's bringing them on to knowing how to file bugs properly in core. Is it in your code base? You know, do you file in core? Do you file in your own bug tracker? Where do I go to the add-on? These 10-minute procedures will save a lot of headache for me. So talking to them and everybody else, because that's a lot of the work that we spend in the community is trying to teach people how to do things right. But if we take this responsibility and ask for help from businesses, it can really make a big difference overall. Mentorship. We're trying to get a mentorship program started for Plone, and it's a little slow to start, but it can also happen at work as well. For example, there was a guy that was working with us who kind of picked up Plone and did it for 3 years on his own, and then started working with myself and Eric. And Eric was awesome enough to be really patient with him and review all of his code diligently for, 3 months, I think. And at the end of 3 months, he was a great Plone developer. It took a little bit of time, and yes, maybe it cost, I don't know, $200 in the end worth of review time or something like that. But not only was he really cheap because he didn't realize how valuable he was now that he was a good Plone developer, and now he's moving on to get a PhD in accounting or something, and all of us are dramatically sad because he became exactly what we wanted for the community. So you can do that. It doesn't cost as much as you think it does, and it's just about making sure that they have it. Not every company is bad. I mean, I don't mean to say this at all, but I think that there's a lot of things that you can do besides that. Hosting a sprint is a great way to contribute back. Not only is it fun because you get to see everybody, you get to introduce people to other parts of culture, other cultures and other people, and see them in person. I know that I am dramatically grateful for all of the travel that I have been able to do because of Plone, and I really wish that I could take my experiences and just give them to everybody else and say, this is like the best 5 years of my life of travel and culture and understanding people. And it's my wish that everybody in Plone gets to do that. You know, so I have an open door policy. If you're in San Francisco and you want to, or if you want to go visit San Francisco, you are welcome to my couch or my extra bedroom or whatever. So just find me. And I think that almost everybody in Plone has that. So let's continue to do that. Encourage people to come. And if you want to get something done, host a sprint. You know, I keep waiting for Japan to say, we really need internationalization, because I will be there tomorrow. And I know there's plenty of people in this audience who would do the same thing. So, you know, do that. Sending people to conferences, obviously you're all here, but also sending non-technical people to conferences. I think there's this kind of thing where we always say that if you can get them to a conference, we'll get them to stay. Because it's really great community and people get here. Having them do case studies. I know hosting a conference, it's really hard to do talk selection. And actually, we don't always have as many talks as we'd like. So if we get a lot, there's a lot of people who would come to this conference if there was more things like case studies and talks about non-developer topics. So having somebody give a talk is a really great way not only to get saved 50 euros on your ticket, but to share what you're doing with everybody. And I'm really happy that Brasilia is here and they're gonna give a great case study. So if you guys wanna see what kind of talks I'm talking about, please go to any of those talks from those guys because they do a really great job. We also have a little bit of a problem of sharing our projects with people. And I don't really know how to fix this yet because there's something that's personal about giving a demo of something you've been working on. But I'm going to start that at this conference. So if anybody wants to know what I've been working on or how I use Plone, come find me. And I'm happy to show you the three different projects that I've been working on. And I encourage people to do that more. Because once you see what other people are working on, you're like, holy crap, we could have been coordinating. We could have shared this add-on. I mean, we really actually have an add-on problem with people duplicating the same work, even within the same company. So let's talk about things and what we're doing and be proud of them, because everything I see everybody does is just amazing, and I wish that everybody could see that. There's other things too. Again, these are all little things and they'll all be on the web, so if you have a small company, you can go and find them. We have to encourage people as well and within our own company. All of us have build-outs. Build-out has been really, really amazing. So every new release, the first thing that we do is we get the release, we run it on our staging environment, not our live environment, staging, and make sure that all of our tests run and that nothing has broken dramatically. Now, if you think about that, we're just one person and we have our customizations, or one company, we have our customizations. I have another client with their customizations. But if all of us just take the latest release and run it against our own test cases to make sure things don't dramatically break, we can reduce the amount of time from alpha to release candidate. And so little things like that, and really upgrading and doing this, it should be a 20-minute process that might even be run by a robot. So little things like that help a lot. Have a policy to not fork, or to have to fork and then push back as soon as there's a release, for example. There's a lot of problems with the move to GitHub of forking in terms of fixes being across 7 different repositories or in somebody else's egg cache. All that. Teaching new people how to properly fork, or the forking policy, is a 10-minute task and will save a lot of bugs from going unresolved for a very long time. The other thing that I would like to see more of is PLIPs are usually done now by individual people. And I would love to have a company get behind a PLIP and say, you know what, this really sucks. We're going to redo the group management UI. That would be awesome. And if you had, and you said, okay, company, once a month, every Friday, we're going to work on this PLIP, that you had 3 people working on it, you would get a really high quality PLIP that wasn't at risk of not getting finished. Because what happens when one person does a PLIP, if their schedule gets busy, you know, it just gets delayed and delayed and delayed. So company-sponsored PLIP time would be an amazing thing that I'd love to see happen. And of course, the best thing that you can do is stay this weekend. And I know that most of you have plans, but I know that some of you are flexible. So if you weren't sure if you were going to sprint, I am begging you to stay and sprint. Not only is it the best way to learn Plone and learn things from other people, but you get to really do something awesome and positive for the community. And by the way, doing something positive for the community doesn't mean not working on your own business, for example. I think that it's... You're doing something for the community that is also going to help you in the long run. That's why things like Plone API get so much activity, is because you know that you're going to go home and immediately start using it. So we need more projects like that. I know that I'm going to try to host 2 sprints here. One, we're trying to modernize the Plone contributor agreement process. It's mostly done, so if there's any beginners who've never done a sprint, this is a really great way. There's only like 3 things that need to be done on it, working with workflows and stuff like that. So please come find me. And then also, Goodbye CPY is trying to move out of portal skins and get things like edit and login done there. So the main message I have here is that none of this stuff is magic. And I'm being super explicit here because I know there's a lot of new people and there's people who have different conceptions, but you know, we all need to work together on this and stop relying on 1 or 2 people in the community to make things happen. And I think that that's really happened. When I first gave this talk in February, I was much more bitter about it, but what I've seen in the past 6 months has been so heartwarming and so amazing, and I just wanna say thank you to all the people who have stepped up and really made me like fall in love with Plone all over again. So that's awesome, and we need to continue to make that happen. And I think that we should have a Plone 5 code name, and it should be no more excuses. We have a lot of excuses about complexity, and it seems to be a part of our culture. But if we decide that we're going to fix it and we really make it happen, then we can have it. So that's it. I don't know if I have time for questions. Anybody have a question? Perfect. Well, thank you very much. Oh. What? The mic is fantastic.